you would, take your Bibles, turn to Matthew chapter 5. We're going to look at a sermon I've entitled, Revenge is Not a Dish Best Served Cold. And I'll explain that as we get into the message. But Jesus is saying, don't do it. Don't take revenge. It's not up to you to take personal revenge. In fact, has someone wronged you along the way in life? Jesus says, let it go. That's what the meaning of forgiveness is, to let it go. Would you stand with me as we read from Matthew chapter 5, verses 38 through 42? And there's something I've got to point out before we even read the scripture, okay? I want you to notice all the personal pronouns, because this passage is not intended for government. This passage is intended for you and your personal relationships. This is possibly one of the most misunderstood passages in all the Bible. I want to explain it today, and I'm going to explain it multiple times so that you get it, okay? So let's look at the personal pronouns, because it's intended for you and me personally in our personal relationships. Ye, that's the first one, isn't it? Ye have heard that it hath been said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Remember, Jesus did not come to do away with the law. He came to complete it. Now he says, but I say to you, you personally, about your personal relationships, that you resist not evil, but whosoever shall smite thee on the right cheek, turn him the other also. Now I've got to tell you, he's not talking about assault. He's not talking about somebody that's about to assault you and kill you. And ladies, he's not talking about somebody that's going to beat you. He's talking about an insult. You see, to take the right hand and slap somebody's right cheek, you're doing this. That's an insult. And he says, if somebody insults you, just turn the other cheek. Look at the second one. And if any man will sue thee, another personal pronoun, at the law, and take away thy, another personal pronoun, thy coat, let him have the cloak also. Now, in regular English, that would mean if somebody's going to sue you for your shirt, give them your coat too. Listen, don't sweat the small stuff, amen? That's what he's talking about here. Don't let a little thing become a big thing. And whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him twain, or go two. Listen, again, it's a small thing to go a mile. Go two. Go the extra mile to keep the peace. Give to him that asketh thee, and from him that would borrow of thee, turn thou not away. Listen, if somebody has a need, help meet the need. Amen? Well, let's pray. Father, we thank you for this word. Father, I pray that if there's somebody here that's held on to bitterness, Father, I pray that today this message would help them to let it go so that they wouldn't hurt themselves. Father, just as we have been forgiven, help us to forgive others. Father, I also pray that we would follow Jesus' example. We wouldn't let the little things become big things that would keep us from receiving you as Savior, that would keep us from being right with you. Father, I also pray today, Lord, that if there's somebody here, they've been puffed up, they have been prideful, and Father, they have sought revenge. Father, I pray for that one that, Father, just needs to let it go, lay it at the foot of the cross and receive the Lord Jesus. Father, I pray for believers. Help us to understand this passage that we might be more like Jesus. And I pray this in the wonderful, powerful name of our Savior, Jesus. Amen. You may be seated. Well, today's world sees nothing wrong with getting revenge. In fact, we live in a vengeful world where people just can't let it go. They let things escalate until violence takes place. There's one website that says, have you been wrong, mistreated, annoyed, or ignored? Are you ready to get some payback? Welcome to Masters of Revenge. That's the name of the website. Now, don't anybody write that down. I'm not trying to give you an idea. The website was established in 2004, and for a few hundred dollars, you could pay them to get revenge on somebody. I'm going to tell you, Jesus would say, don't do that. Don't do that. You may have heard the old saying, revenge is a dish best served cold. Now, what does that mean? Well, that means, and it comes from an ancient novel, I say ancient, come from a French novel and written in the 1600s, and it didn't use those exact words. In the French language, it says, revenge is best eaten cold. And what that meant was, is if you got somebody that you're angry with, wait until you're not so hot, and you pick your time, and you get them when they don't know it's coming, and you get them when they're least expecting it. I want you to know Jesus would say that's not the right thing to do. Revenge is not best eaten cold, and it's not eaten hot either. Just let it go is what Jesus is saying about personal revenge. Well, that term became better known in a line from the 1969 movie The Godfather when Don Vito Corleone said, revenge is a dish that tastes best when served cold, but that's not how we use it in English language today. We use it as revenge is a dish best served cold, and that really came into our slang or our language, modern language, from a 1982 movie called The Wrath of Khan. Anybody remember that? And the reason it's called revenge is a dish best served cold because it's very cold in space. Now, I didn't give this to the first service. I'm going to give it to you. There's a problem with that whole saying in that movie. How did Khan know anything about a Klingon saying? He was stuck on the planet. Y'all remember the movie? He said, old Klingon saying. Well, how did he know that? That's a blooper in the movie. Listen, Jesus would say about any of this, let it go. Don't hold on to anger and don't get revenge. You see, this portion of the Sermon on the Mount doesn't set well with people today because today everybody thinks they got their rights and they need to get their revenge. Listen, people don't want to just get mad today. They want to get even. Listen, I'm thankful that revenge is not God's attitude towards sinful people right now. Amen? We have the opportunity to be forgiven by a holy God. Jesus wants a personal relationship with you, and that's why I believe in this whole passage, he emphasizes the personal pronouns. He's talking about me and you, wanting a relationship with us. Sir Francis Bacon wrote, a man that studieth revenge keeps his own wounds green, which otherwise would heal and do well. Are you holding on to anger today? Is there somebody that's wronged you somewhere along the line? Let it go. It's not doing you any good to hold it. It's just hurting you. Let it go. That's what the word forgiveness means. Jesus is saying, forgive those that insult you. Now, let's take a look at this passage, because again, this is such a misunderstood passage. First of all, let's look at an exclamation. Because this is an exclamation, an exact quotation from an Old Testament passage that dealt with the legal system. Exodus 21, verse 24, comes right after the Ten Commandments, and it says, an eye for an eye, a tooth for tooth, a hand for hand, a foot for foot. This was part of the legal system that God established to be carried out in a legal way by a God-ordained legal authority. In fact, Exodus Leviticus 24:21 says, "He that killeth a man shall be put to death." And the word "killeth" there means to do murder. In other words, Jesus was simply quoting the law that was intended to be carried out by the governing authorities, but he was warning people, don't you take personal revenge. Listen, the purpose of the Old Testament law was twofold. First of all, one was to reduce the occurrence of crime. And that's your fill in the blank. The twofold law was given, first of all, to reduce the occurrence of crime. Deuteronomy 19, verse 20 says, "And those which remain shall hear and fear, and shall henceforth commit no more any such evil among you." Listen, the legal system was given by God to reduce crime. The problem with the legal system today is oftentimes the punishment doesn't fit the crime. And second of all, oftentimes it's never carried out. Listen, the Bible prescribes some pretty tough penalty for some pretty tough crimes. And when the criminal punishment matches the crime, the Bible says it will deter crime, and I believe it will. Unfortunately, today in our legal system, it's become unjust and way too political. Lady Justice is supposed to be blind, and law is supposed to be implemented to everybody equally. And that's what God prescribed in the Word. And then two, the law of God was given to prevent excessive criminal punishment by a governing authority. You see, it didn't take long for mankind to pervert the law of God. In fact, in Genesis 4:24, instead of just meeting a crime with a just punishment, it says they were going to do it 70 times. Listen, this passage was given so that we personally do not take the law into our own hands. Listen, it's important to note that criminal punishment is to be carried out by a legal justice system or a biblically ordained governing authority. So what was Jesus really saying here? He was saying, if someone wrongs you, don't you become the law. Don't you become the police officer, the judge, the jury, and the executioner. You've got to take it to the legal authorities. Let it go. There is no place for revenge in the Christian heart. Now, that doesn't mean that we ignore the criminal legal system. If someone has broken the law, then Christian, listen to me, we need to report it. Amen? Church, listen to me. If somebody is abusing a child, you have a responsibility to report it to the legal system. Amen. If someone has committed a crime, then you have every right to expect the legal system to hold people accountable. What he's saying here is, don't you take it upon your own heart, because you'll just break your own heart. You've got to let it go. Don't be vengeful. If someone has wronged you, don't you take it upon yourself. You let the legal authorities deal with a crime. But you lay it at the foot of the cross where there is forgiveness. Listen, the trouble, again, with today's justice system is it's become way too political. And we have seen that even this week, haven't we? Listen, in any case, Jesus was saying, you personally don't have a right to take revenge. Second of all, there's an explanation. And this verse 39 may be the most misinterpreted and misunderstood statement in the Sermon on the Mount, if not the entire Bible. In fact, let's look at verse 39 again. Jesus says, "But I say to you that ye resist not evil, but whosoever shall smite thee on the right cheek, turn him the other also. Now, you got to keep Scripture in context. He says if someone comes up to you and gives you a backhand, that's an insult. In fact, according to Jewish custom, a backhand was twice as insulting as a forehand. Now listen, that's not saying that if somebody intends to do you bodily harm and assault you, you don't have a right to defend yourself. What he's saying is, if somebody is insulting you, just turn the other cheek. It's not worth escalating that to a place where somebody gets killed. Let it go. You got to keep this in its context for it to be properly understood. That's the explanation. Listen to me. The explanation is the Russian Christian writer Leo Tolstoy studied the Sermon on the Mount and wrote a book entitled What I Believe. And what's wrong with it is while I believe he was sincere, he was sincerely wrong. Because he came to believe that based on what this passage had to say, that a Christian should never serve in law enforcement. I want to tell you today, I am thankful for the men and women who serve in law enforcement. Amen? I am thankful that they put their lives on the line to maintain law and order. It's a thin blue line that separates us from anarchy, and I'm thankful for the men and women in law enforcement. Leo Tolstoy was wrong. Second, he said that a Christian should never serve in the armed forces. I want to tell you, I'm thankful for our men and women who serve our armed forces. Amen? We have some in our own congregation that serve in various branches of service. I'm thankful for the service that they give, serving under a legal authority ordained by God. Listen, he also said that a Christian should never take part in the court system. Never serve on a jury because they have no right. Listen, I'm going to tell you, you have every right and responsibility to expect that the laws are carried out. And Christian, listen to me, we ought to be law-abiding citizens. Amen? Amen? That is not what Jesus was saying. And some have tried to apply this passage to government and say that government should be passive. I want you to know, Jesus was not saying that we should put up with injustice. He was not saying that we should be pacifists. In fact, Jesus said this as he was getting ready to go to the cross. He said, if you've got a purse, if you've got a cloak, you sell whatever you have to sell and get a sword. I want you to know, I believe it's almost a Christian responsibility to obey what Jesus had to say. We are living in evil times. One sheriff here in Florida said, it is now become war, and encourages citizens to take up arms. I want you to know, Jesus was not saying that we should be passive and just sit back and allow persecution and killing of fellow Christians. In fact, I believe Christians have a responsibility, according to the Word of God, to defend the innocent. Amen? Amen. As we look around our world and we see 90,000 Christians killed last year, if we don't speak up now about a false religion killing Christians around the world, if we don't speak up now, when are we going to speak up? All that's necessary for evil to reign is for good people to say nothing and do nothing. I want to tell you what Jesus did. You want to be more like Jesus? Listen to Matthew 21, 12. And by the way, he was the just authority. He's God, the Son, and the Son of God. And Jesus went into the temple of God and cast out all of them that sold and bought in the temple and overthrew their tables and the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves. Another passage says what he did was he made himself a whip. He's going to give somebody a beating. Amen? Amen. That sweet, loving Jesus, he loved God enough to put a stop and resist evil. You see, in this passage, when it says resist evil, you got to keep it in its context. He's saying when somebody insults you, listen, don't escalate violence. That's what he was saying. What did Jesus mean when he said resist not evil? First of all, he did not mean to tolerate ongoing evil. Again, I'm repeating myself, but Christians are obligated to follow the law. And friend, listen to me. If you know of somebody that's abusing a child, you have an obligation to report it to the legal authorities. If you see a man about to beat a woman, you need to call the police. When you see a crime taking place, you not only need to call the police, you need to serve as a witness. We need to put a stop to crime, not enable it. That is not what Jesus meant. Second of all, he did not mean that we do not have the legal right to protect ourselves and a legal right to stop an attack when people's lives are in danger. Resist here in this passage means it's not our position to carry out vengeance or revenge on another. By the way, most concealed carry laws say that you have no right to carry out revenge. I know this may sound strange, but ladies, if you carry and somebody rapes you, and after it's all over with, gets up and walks away and you shoot them, you're guilty of murder. Did you know that? You don't have the right, even according to our own legal system, man. If somebody's already laid the beating on you and then he's walking away, and then you shoot him, you're guilty of murder. Now, where would our founders come up with these kind of ideas? Listen, the founding fathers of our nation knew this word. Amen? Amen. You don't have the right to carry out revenge. And Jesus made that personally clear to us here. Personal vengeance has no place among those who belong to Christ. The Bible says this in the Old Testament, say not, I will do so to him as he's done to me. I'll render to that man according to his work. No, you don't. You let the legal authorities handle it. Romans 12, 17 through 19 says, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Avenge not yourselves. Listen, we don't have the right to take the law into our hands. We need to live peaceably with people, lovingly with people. And Romans 12, verses 20 and 21 says, therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. Again, he's speaking to us personally. This is not a verse for the government. Listen, when you're at war, you destroy your enemy at war. But yet that is done through the legal authorities. I'm glad we got General Mattis on duty, amen? He doesn't stay awake at night being afraid of what might happen. He wants to make sure that our enemies stay awake at night wondering what he's going to do to them. Listen, God has appointed governments and has given instructions to them, but that's another sermon for another day. But I will say this. We need to respect the God-ordained legal authorities. And then third, let's look at the examination. Because Jesus illustrates his point about personally taking revenge. First of all, and I've already mentioned it, the smitten example in verse 39. He says, don't let an insult grow into a major conflict. If somebody slapped you with the back of the hand, turn the other cheek. Let it go. Listen, don't be a hothead. And I'm going to say this to you. I know what Jesus said about selling your cloak if you have to or emptying your purse to get a sword. If you got a hothead, don't carry anything. Amen? And if you're a Christian, you got a hothead, you need to go to the cross and do something about that. Amen? That is not Christ-like. Listen, he's saying, somebody's insulted you. Let it go. Don't sweat the small stuff. And then the second example is the being sued example. And in particular, he's saying, if somebody takes your coat, give them your cloak also. Now let me give you that in the English, today's English version. If somebody sues you for your shirt, just give them your coat. It's not worth fighting over, amen? Don't sweat the small stuff. Let it go. The third example is the service example, found in 41. The Roman law said that if a Roman soldier called upon someone that was a civilian to carry his pack for him, that you were obligated to carry the soldier's pack for a mile. Jesus said, don't carry it just 1 mile. Carry it two. Amen? He's a legal authority representing the government, and that's the law. Don't argue. Just carry it the second mile. Not long after I came to Yulee, I got pulled over by one of our sheriff officers. You know what I got pulled over for? Because I had a clear license tag cover. When he pulled me over, he said, that's illegal. I said, yes, sir, let me get it off. Truth is, I don't think it's illegal, but I didn't going to argue with him. Instead, I said, while I'm taking this off, can I ask you a question? Do you know for certain you have eternal life and are going to go to heaven when you die? He said, well, you can take that off some other time. I said, no, I'm going to take it off now. I said, I got a little booklet for you. Let me hand you this tract right here. I started going through the booklet with him. When I got done, I said, now, is it really that I got to take this off? And he said, well, he said, I didn't recognize the car, and I just wanted to see who was in here. I said, well, now you know, I'm the preacher down here at Yulee Baptist. I'm looking for you Sunday. Listen, I could have been a total jerk. Listen, you get pulled over by one of our fine legal authorities, be sweet, amen? If you're not sweet, tell them you go to some other church. But you be sweet and invite them to Yulee Baptist. You do what they ask you to do. Listen, they're carrying a heavy pack. Do you understand that two of our local law officers had to pull out a gun and shoot somebody in the line of duty this past week? That's a heavy load. We need to make their load light, amen? So don't be a jerk when you get pulled over for doing something wrong, or even if you're not doing something wrong. Talk about Jesus and be a blessing to our law enforcement officers. And to those serving our nation, be sweet and carry their pack for them that extra mile they're serving in the military. Listen, this is the service example. And then finally, Jesus gives the sacrifice example. He says, when you see somebody in genuine need, help them out. Amen? Listen, some of you say, well, you know what? I give my 10% to the Lord. It's not just your 10%. Jesus owns the other 90% too. Did you know that? The 10% we give back in the offering plate, the other 90%, it still belongs to Him. We just manage it for Him. You're a steward of all that God gives you. And so when you see somebody in need, Jesus says, help them out. Have a compassionate heart. Not only be peaceful, be loving and caring. I'm thankful. That's what Jesus was to me. In spite of my sin, Jesus personally loves me. And I want you to know, if you're here today, Jesus loves you. Do you know that? And He wants a personal relationship with you. Listen, when you examine these four illustrations, you see that Jesus practiced what He preached. He was personally smitten for our sin. didn't retaliate. Matthew 26, verses 67 and 68 says, "Then did they spit in his face." I want you to know, there's no greater insult in all the world than somebody spitting in your face. I can honestly say I don't think that's ever happened to me, so don't anybody here do that to me, okay? Isn't that amazing? Jesus didn't retaliate. He took the insult for me and for you. Oh, listen, it wasn't just that. They took his shirt and his cloak. In fact, they took it all. The Bible says in Luke 24, verse 34, "And they parted his raiment." That means they took his clothes off and cast lots. He gave everything he had in this world for you and for me. Oh, but friend, that wasn't the greatest sacrifice. You see, in John 19, 17, it says, "And he, bearing his cross, went forth into a place called the place of the skull." Oh, listen to me. Jesus took the cross for you and for me. And there he hung, suspended between heaven and earth. And he shed his rich royal blood because he wants a personal relationship with you and me. He paid for our sin. Amen? Amen. I owed a debt I couldn't pay. He paid a debt he didn't know. I needed someone to take away my sin. Oh, Jesus did that for me. Everything he preached on the Sermon on the Mount, he did himself for you and for me, that we could be forgiven and we could have a personal relationship with him. Is there something you need to let go? Is there somebody you need to forgive? Friend, let it go. Do you need to change your attitude? Quit being a hothead? You need to turn the other cheek to an insult. You need to give to someone in need. I'm thankful that Jesus gave it all for me. Hebrews 12, verse 2 says, "Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down now at the right hand of the throne of God." Oh, what a Savior. Amen. Have you been given grace? Then be gracious to others. Has God's grace changed you? Then live graciously to others. What does your attitude, what do your actions say about who you really are inside? That's what Jesus was saying. Don't take revenge. Let it go. Is there something you need to leave at the cross? Maybe you've been beating yourself up. Maybe it's you that you need to forgive. Would you find forgiveness from God, then leave it at the cross and move on? Today's the first day of a new life. If you receive the Lord, if you leave it behind. Maybe you're a Christian, you're here today. You need to come and get something right with God here today. Maybe you need to come. Maybe you don't remember a time in your life when you received Christ as your personal Savior. Maybe today's the day. You need to repent from sin and turn to Christ to be more like Him, to ask forgiveness of sin. Do you need to come today and be saved, forgiven of your sin? Let me share one more thing. Right now, Jesus is in a position where He offers you a personal relationship. But one day He's coming as the righteous king and the judge to exact justice in this world. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death. And friend, Jesus has already paid that. But if you reject Christ, one day you'll stand at the great white throne. And there you will pay the penalty for your sin and spend eternity separated from God in an awful place called hell. What What an awful thing that would be when today you can receive Christ as your Savior. He endured the insult. He gave it all because He loves you. Would you love Him in return? Would you receive Him as your Savior? And if you have received Him, then you need to be more like Jesus. Let go of personal revenge. Support the governing authorities in carrying out the justice system. But know that one day, justice will be done. Have your sins already been paid for on the cross? Or are you willing to go through this life and to pay for your own sin by spending eternity in an awful place called hell? What will you do with Jesus? Will you receive Him? Or will you reject Him?